you, Sean, and Brother Arch and Miss Pat for the special music this morning. Just a blessing for all of it this morning. If you will, open your Bibles to John chapter 14, verse 22 through 24. I desire your prayers this morning. It's just been a rough 2 days. It's just don't seem real that what's happened has happened with Roy. So I desire your prayers. It's just been very difficult to focus, to try to study the last couple of days. I just desire your prayers. Roy and I had a special relationship that Joyce didn't know anything about, Mom and Jean didn't know anything about, nobody knows anything about but me and Roy. Roy was just probably as oddball as I am, and nobody knew when me and him talked except me and Roy. And just missing. He was sitting right back there about where Buddy's sitting last Sunday morning, involved in the sermon, nodding his head and involved in the sermon and how uncertain life really is. And we need to all realize that they had plans as quick as Roy would be back to be at the coffee shop in a little while, and at 3 o'clock be eating out and celebrating Joyce's birthday that very day. And all of that changed, and how uncertain life is. Don't matter what our age is, God's the one that holds life and death in His hands. And when you check out from this world, it's not in your control. It's not in my control. It's whenever God says time on earth for you it will be no more, that's when you'll check out and stand before Him, and life on earth will be no more. Yeah. But I just desire your prayers this morning. John chapter 14, we're going to read verses 22 through 24. If you can comfortably stand, please do so in reverence to the reading of God's word. If not, please remain seated. John chapter 14, verse 22. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? So Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. Take a moment, ask the Holy Spirit, prepare your heart for His word this morning. Heavenly Father, as we bow in your presence this morning, we come, Father, with your word open. Jesus is speaking to the 11 disciples that are still in the upper room, giving a final discourse, giving some final instructions, talking to them heart to heart, because he knows that this is the last moments that he'll spend with them before his death on the cross. God, we know that they're asking questions. They have very curious minds, wondering what he's saying to them, and he's going to be leaving them, and different things that he said to them, and they're so confused and wondering what he's trying to say and what it really means by what he is saying. So, Father, we just ask you, Father, as they were trying to figure out some things that he was saying to them and what he meant by them, as we've read three of the verses and what Judas has asked to him, and not the one that was betraying him, but he had already left the 12 and was gone on trying to find someone to betray Jesus. But there was another one that had a question for him, and you had an answer. Jesus, as we look at that passage of scripture and a couple of the verses of the answer that you gave to him, would you just open our hearts and our minds, and would you take the presence of the Holy Spirit that has been sent back? We're going down in the next few verses that we didn't read this morning, and we find that you were talking about the Holy Spirit, and you talked about it earlier. But that Holy Spirit has already come back, and it's manifested in us, it's indwelling in us, so it can teach us, it can bring to remembrance things that you've taught us in the Word, in our private time of sitting down with the Word and being taught by you. So would you just manifest yourself to us? Would you make yourself clearly known to us as we look into your Word this morning? Would you reveal yourself to us? If there's someone here today, Father, that's struggling in their spiritual walk with you, would you right now begin, Father, to let them know that you want to make yourself known to them, that you want them to have a clear understanding of you, that you want them to have a beautiful fellowship with you, that you want to have a love relationship with them, that you want to commune with them, that you want to have a close relationship with them, that if they'll draw near to you, that you'll draw near to them, and that there's things in their life that you're wanting moved out of their life so that you can have that near and dear relationship with them. And God, just help them to see how to move those things out of their life right now as the service begins and the preaching of your Word, and just work with them, Holy Spirit, to confess those things, repent of those things, turn from those things. And if there's someone here today that don't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, I just pray that repentance would begin in their heart and in their life, that they would see what a wonderful love that you had on the cross as you gave your life completely, died upon the cross for our sins. And that's the only way that we can have a right relationship with God, is to put our faith and trust in you and what you did on the cross, and that would be made right with you before this service comes to an end. Lift up Miss Joyce this morning and ask you, Father, to be with her in a very, very special way. God, the presence of your Holy Spirit is the only thing that can give her the comfort that she needs. We praise you for your people and for them being there with her, but we know that it takes something from the throne of grace, from the throne of God, from the presence of your throne to be able to comfort her, God. And I just pray for you to be that very presence and put your arms around her, pick her up and carry her, Father, and let her see one set of footprints when she looks back at this time in her life and know that she was carried by your very presence during this time. In Jesus' precious holy name I pray, amen. As we look at this passage of scripture, going back to verse 22, we see that Judas said to him, Jesus, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? So Judas has asked a question here directly to Jesus. Lord, or Jesus, how is it that you, Jesus, will manifest? How is it that you will make yourself obvious to us? You will let us be able to see you, understand you, become able to clearly visualize, see you, understand you, know you, and the world not be able to see you. Now, how would that physically be possible? Because if we can see you, the world can see you. If we can't see you, the world can't see you. That just made common sense to Judas and the other 10 that were standing around. So, and reason that he asked that question, and I didn't ask Caleb to put this passage of scripture up, but it goes right on with this scripture, is verse 21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. So he has just said that if you keep my commandments, then That is a way of showing that you love me, and my Father will love you and will manifest ourselves to you. And so Judas is saying, how are you going to manifest yourself to us and the world not be able to see you also? So Jesus is about to answer that question starting in verse 23. So remember the question that is asked. How can you manifest yourself to us and not manifest yourself to the world? That's the question that Judas has just asked. So Jesus is about to answer that question. Jesus answered and said to him, he's speaking specifically to Judas, but the other 10 can hear the answer that Jesus is about to give. Now I want you to notice how that he individualizes this. And I want us to realize today that I think we are casting blame on all of the sinfulness and all of the wickedness of the world today and all of the lukewarmness of the world today, and we're blaming everybody but ourselves. Is that not kind of the way the world is today? We want to look around, and anybody that makes any kind of mistake today, it's somebody else's fault. Is that not pretty well the way the world is today? If it's a car wreck, if it's anything that happens in the world today, it's somebody else's fault. It's not our fault. And the reason Copper Springs is not growing today, if I ask, I'll promise you, you wouldn't say it's my fault. You'd say it's somebody else's fault. You wouldn't point your finger and say, I'm the reason that Copper Springs is not doing any better than it is today. You'd point your finger at somebody else. It's the preacher's fault. It's the deacon's fault. It's the song leader's fault. It's somebody else's fault besides my own fault. But this verse right here is going to destroy every bit of that. Because he said, Jesus answered and said to him, if you want the power, if you want Jesus, if you want God manifested, if anyone, that means anybody here or everyone here, but it's individualized. It says get in a circle, take you a piece of chalk when you get home, or take you a rock and get out in the sand or the dirt and draw you a circle and get inside that circle and say, if I want revival, start it right here in this circle and find out with God, what do I need to do to get revival started, and start it right here in this circle, and you'll find out that God's willing to do some work in your life if you'll get everybody else and everybody else's business out of your life and say, I'm just worried about what's inside this circle and I'm not worried about anything outside this circle. You might find out that God might be willing to do some work in your life. Amen. Because what that says is Jesus said to him, if anyone loves me, that's a one-on-one relationship. Am I right or wrong according to the scripture? If anyone, any individual loves me, Jesus, a love relationship, he will keep part of my word, the one part that he really likes the best. No, that's not what he said. He said he will keep my word. And I'm going somewhere with this. We keep what we want to keep, and we leave the rest. And we're getting further and further away from what we want to keep. Let's just admit it. When this church started, I'll just use Copper Springs Baptist Church for an example. When this church started, we started, and then we had started with church, and then we had Sunday school, and then we had Sunday night church, and then we started Wednesday night church, and then we had a young man that wanted to start a 5 o'clock Bible study. And then we had people that were starting Sunday school classes, and I had people knocking me down wanting to know, can I help with this Sunday school class and that Sunday school class and another Sunday school class, and knocking people down wanting to help. What's happened to that today? If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. We need to fall in love with Jesus. Don't fall in love with your pastor. Don't fall in love with your church. Don't fall in love with Guy, Arkansas. Don't fall in love with anything but Jesus himself. You know why? Because look, that right there. He's the one that hung and died on the cross. But we find some way to eliminate Wednesday night. We find some way to eliminate Sunday night. We find some way to eliminate Sunday school. We find some way to eliminate instead of add to, don't we? If anyone loves me, where's the love at? If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him. And then we come to we, he's joining up with the Father here now. We, my Father and Jesus, will come to him. This is still an individual. This is not a church. This is an individual. This is an individual. What is the church made up of? The church is made up of individuals. Am I correct or not? We like to think of a church as a church in a building that we see a steeple set on top of, and a church is a church that we walk inside, double doors, it's got glass doors on, and we come in and we sit down in comfortable chairs, and that's what we want to call a church. Well, I want you to know, Jesus is talking to a church. He's talking to individuals, and when individuals fall in love with Jesus, you'll find a church that's going to be on fire for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But until individuals fall in love with Jesus, you'll find that it'll be a building that'll have individuals with clothing on it, and you'll find individuals gathering together, but no power of the love of Jesus Christ. But notice what he said, my Father will love him, and we'll come to him, and what will we do? We will make our home with him. Woo. That's a pretty strong statement, is it not? Now I've got Jesus and God making a home with who? With the individual that loves me and keeps my word. Am I reading anything into that verse that Jesus didn't speak out of his own mouth? Judas has said, I want to know how you're going to manifest yourself to me and to these other 10 without manifesting yourself to the world. And Jesus said, it's pretty plain and it's pretty simple. If any individual wants to keep my word, my Father will love him, and me, Jesus, and my Father will come to him, and we will make a home there with him. Man, there's so many verses that just start, if God be for us, who can be against us? If God and Jesus are making a home in your individual life or my individual life, what can stop the power of God from moving throughout Guy, Arkansas, Copper Springs Baptist Church and doing a powerful work through an individual?
Amen.
According to the Word of God, if God be for us, who can be against us? But I want us to look, because he goes in the next verse, and I'm just going to spend just a minute here on verse 24. He said, he who does not love me does not keep my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. He said, I'm just the spokesman. I'm just telling you what God told me to tell you. That's what Jesus is basically saying. I'm just speaking for the Father. So I'm going to step one step down and say, I'm just speaking for God the Father and Jesus the Son, because that's what the Word of God says. And I don't feel like I've misrepresented anything to you this morning. I've read it straight to you out of the Word of God. I want us to go to Revelation this morning, chapter 2. I know that there's a lot of people that say this is phases of churches, church dispensations in the last days. There was a church, and we're studying that letter to the church in Ephesus on Wednesday night. But there was actually a church that was named Ephesus that Paul established. Paul wrote a letter to. But there was a letter that was written to that church by Jesus that John the Revelator spoke about in the book of Revelation. And I thought that it was so amazing. I jotted down, and I'm going to point out to you, 9 different things that he said, you're doing a good job. 9 different things that he said, church at Ephesus, I like it. I like it. You're doing good. He goes through 9 different things. I'm going to read them to you. And then he throws in a big old word there. Nevertheless. Nevertheless, after all these 9 good things that I've told you about, you've lost your first love. And that word nevertheless, I just looked it up in Webster's dictionary, and it means that they're literally true, but they're misleading. What he said about the church was not untrue, but they were misleading because they didn't have the love to go with them. Wow. Let's see what they were doing right. Let's start with verse 2. I know your works. So they had some works going on, didn't they? I know your labor. So they was not only working, but they had labored. That's number 2. They had some patience. Church has been here for 18 years. You cannot bear those who are evil. Hang in there. That's number 4. You've tested those who say that they are apostles. They are not. You found them liars. That's number 5. Let's look at verse 3. You persevered. That's number 6. There's patience again. He must have been proud of their patience. That's number 6. You've labored for my name's sake. Man, you've not only labored, but you've labored for my name's sake. That's number 7. You've not become weary. That's number 8. Let's look at verse 4. Oop, I must have skipped one somewhere. You have not become weary. You've labored for my name's sake, and you have not become weary. That was number 9. 9 good qualities. Now this is Jesus speaking. Church, focus with me for just a minute. This is Jesus speaking out of his mouth. 9 good qualities. You've labored, you've had patience, you've worked, you've done cast out evil. You've got 9 good qualities going your way. Then all of a sudden in number 4, nevertheless, let me read you that definition. Literally true but misleading. How could they be true but misleading? I have this against you, that you have left your first love. I want you to think about it, church. Where's your first love? Jesus was saying to the church at Ephesus, I'm not your first love anymore. Now that was Jesus speaking to the church. Was he speaking to these sheetrock walls? Was he speaking to them glass doors? Was he speaking to the temple on top of the roof when he said you've left your first love? When he was saying you've labored hard, you've been patient, you've persevered, was he speaking to the sheetrock walls, or was he speaking to those anyone? He's speaking to anyone's, wasn't he? And now he's still speaking to anyone. You have left your first love. This is not the hardest part of it. That's sad for me to think that we might have left our first love, but I want you to look at what Jesus said in the next verse. This is not Gary speaking. This is Jesus speaking. Let's look at verse 5. First of all, he said, get your mind to thinking. Because to remember says to engage your mind. Remember from where you've fallen. We don't want to go back there, do we? Where's your mind? What does it stay engaged with? Do you ever sit down and let your mind go back to what it used to be with your love for Jesus? Just to see, maybe it slipped. Or does it stay engaged in all of the things of this old world? Does Satan not do a wonderful job keeping us? I was talking to a guy this week that just laid it out, some of the things that he was going through. How that he felt like he was going to church, sitting on the pews. Satan was happy with exactly what he was doing. I mean, he just laid it out. I get up, put my clothes on, I go to church, I sit in the pews, I listen to the sermon, I go back home, I do the same thing week after week after week. He said, I think Satan's very, very pleased with the routine I'm in right now. He didn't say, I think I've left my first love, but that's what it all ended up at. Remember from where you have fallen. But he didn't stop there. You can remember, But then he said, repent. And repent means to change. It goes from the mind to a change to an action, because he said, repent and do the first works. Remember who's talking. It's not Gary Burton. It's Jesus. And remember the next two words. Or else. The word or else is used to warn what will happen if this is not carried out. That's what Webster Dictionary says. Or else. That's out of the mouth of Jesus. I'm warning you. If this is not carried out, if what's not carried out? If you don't remember from where you've fallen, and you don't repent and do your first works, or else, Jesus said, I will come quickly. There's about three phases to this. I will come. I will come quickly. And I will remove your lampstand from its place. You know what a lampstand's used for? For a light to be in it. And then he goes right back and uses that unless. Or else you repent. Repent, or else I will remove unless you repent. You think Jesus could get any more plainer than what he just got? Jesus wasn't just trying to fill a verse up, make it longer. He meant what he said, don't you think? Wonder why the churches are the way they are today? Think the influence, the power, that maybe some of that's already happened in the churches today. The influence, the power, protection. There's a lot of debate of what that lampstand and what it really stands for. Whether it's the influence, the power, the light, the gospel. Jesus said, unless these things happen, I will come quickly. I will remove unless there's repentance. Musicians, would you come?